Existence has not come easily or lightly. It's taken 15 billion years to make you possible. As Thich Nhat Hanh, the Vietnamese Buddhist monk, says, when you look at a flower, he says, you are seeing the whole universe, because it's taken the whole universe to birth one flower. In the flower are the clouds. The clouds bring the rain. In the flower is the sun. In the flower is the soil. But the sun has its history. It is only 5.5 billion years old. It was birthed by a supernova explosion, which in turn was birthed by galaxies, which in turn were birthed by atoms, which in turn was birthed by the original fireball. So just as a flower takes 15 billion years of work and labor on the universe's part to be here, so too does each of us. And that's where the joy comes in, and that's where the praise comes in. So we'll be honoring in particular, in this ritual we'll be doing before long, the sacredness of our bodies. That will be the theme of the ritual, since clearly that is a theme directly, indirectly, of this conference. So we will be dancing in the presence of the holy temple of the organs of our bodies. And we will be doing a litany, which is a call and response kind of prayer in the middle of this. Being reverent and grateful, that appreciation theme, for each of our organs. We'll hear very briefly the gift that our organs offer us, and we'll be invited to respond. But in addition to just the litany and the call and response, we will be experiencing the turning this room into a temple of the sacred body. We did a ritual like this for 400 doctors in Philadelphia a couple of years ago. It's a very ugly convention room, and but we had the screens, and we had the organs of the body, and we had these 400 doctors dancing in the holy temple, sacred body, to techno music, which is what we'd be doing, for about 35 minutes back then. And when we were finished, this one doctor came up to me, and he was absolutely glassy-eyed, and he was like drunk. And he stood in front of me kind of waving like this for a minute in silence. And then he said, he started to stutter, and he said, do you do this for lawyers too? Anyone who admits to having a body, yes. But what had happened that night was this fellow, who has obviously been very trained in the left hemisphere of his brain, had had his right hemisphere opened up. And that's why he was drunk. And that's the whole point, folks. Aquinas, Thomas Aquinas in the 13th century, who, by the way, was condemned by the church 3 times, and then they canonized him a saint, which is really fun to remember. Aquinas has a line from the psalmist. The psalmist says, they should get drunk on the plenty of thy house. And Aquinas says, i.e., the universe. We are here to get drunk on the beauty of the universe. That's where the joy comes from, friends. It comes from the universe. If we get overly anthropocentric and human-centered, which is what our culture has taught us to be, and the media is so often enmeshed in, if we get overly anthropocentric, of course we'll become cynical. If you only look at human history and the human news, there's every reason to be depressed. But I heard an interview this past year with a Holocaust survivor, and he was talking about how the shacks in which they were housed in Buchenwald were very badly built. And there were cracks between the wood in the huts. And he said this, he said, no matter what the Nazis did to us or tried to do to us, day or night, the sun and the moon kept shining through the cracks. And he said, this is what kept me alive. This is what gave me hope. And that is why, my friends, cosmology is so important for all of us today. Our hope must come from the real story of our existence. And that is that we were not made by any corporation or .com. We were brought here by eons of light and struggle and beauty and birthing and dying. That has what's brought us here. Many sacrifices and many efforts at joy. Aquinas says, sheer joy is God's, and this demands companionship. In other words, the very reason for the existence of the universe is the divine joy. And it is this that will move us ultimately to our own destiny. Now, a big part of what we do in the rituals that we've developed is dance. We'll be doing a lot of dancing this evening. And I think that's altogether appropriate. For one thing, you've probably been sitting for quite a while at this conference, because that's how conferences are usually devised. But even if you weren't at the conference, you probably do quite a lot of sitting in our culture. In African languages, many African languages, the word for dance is the same as the word for breathe. To dance is to breathe. And of course, when you think about it, it's pretty practical. It's hard to dance without breathing. And in addition, in many African languages, the word for breathe is the same as the word for spirit. So dance, breath, spirit. The same is true in Hebrew, of course, that breath and spirit are the same words. So to breathe is to invite spirit alive again. And to allow yourself to let go and to be taken over by spirit, to get lost in the temple. To get lost in the temple. We need so much of this in our culture. It's what Meister Eckhart called unselfconsciousness, getting lost. We're taught at so many levels of our adulthood not to get lost, but to be in control and to be self-conscious instead of unselfconscious. Now, you'll find as we do this ritual this evening, during the dancing, the only lights will probably come from the pictures. And that's how it should be. That invites you to be unselfconscious. As you know, the right brain is most happy and it's spontaneous and truthful in the dark. You need the lights on for your left hemisphere of the brain because you've got to read. But the right hemisphere learns in different ways. So being in the dark together is one of the subtle ways of creating healthy community and spontaneity. Many of the methods, the language really, that we have employed for our technocosmic masses and for our techno-rituals are taken from the rave movement in today's youth culture. How many of you know what a rave is? Okay, it's getting around. It's about half of you or so. Well, just in a few sentences, a rave is an all-night dance where the purpose is to go into a trance. It's called trance dance, trance music. And the purpose is to get high. Now, the danger in rave today is that it's going the way of the drug ecstasy and of entrepreneurship. So one of the things we're trying to do is to demonstrate to young people in particular that you can get high dancing if you connect the dance to a ritual, to a liturgical tradition, and you don't need the drugs. And it's cheaper and it's safer, much safer. A study just came out this week on the drug ecstasy from Germany demonstrating that it really does negatively affect the intellect. And it is a dangerous drug, even though it seems sometimes gets you high. It also makes people depressed. I've seen studies about that. And I've met enough people from the rave community to know that it can have an overall depressing effect, even though in the short term you seem to get high on it. So, but my point is that this first postmodern generation, these young people who are doing rave dancing all over the world, I met a fellow from South Africa who helped us with our techno mass we did in Colorado last year. He's done raves in South Africa, Thailand, Japan, Paris, London, South America, and North America. It is a universal form of celebration today. And it is bringing the goddess back, because the goddess cares about celebration, as Marija Gambutsa said. So that's part of what we'd be doing tonight, too, is bringing the goddess back through our praise and our sense of joy. And through the stories that the images can tell us. Images can tell us stories that speak right directly to the heart. And that's a good thing. And we can all respond then in gratitude for that. Obviously, if ritual and community go together, this is important today because community was so wounded in the modern era. After all, we were taught that the physics, the atoms, the building blocks of matter, were rugged billiard balls competing against each other for space. That was the physics of the Newtonian era. That destroys community, obviously. It's about survival of the fittest. It's the winner versus loser. Now, today's physics is throwing that out. It says, oops, we were wrong. Atoms aren't that way. Atoms are more like bubbles. They link up. When an atom links up with another atom, we have molecules. When molecules link up, we have cells. When cells link up, we have communities. So now we have a physics in the microcosmic order, in the small of things, that supports community again, which is about interdependence. Community is about interdependence. And of course, at the macro level, we also are relearning the story I've been alluding to from the start here, that we are kin, that we are connected with all the other beings of the universe. So in our species, this can come together, the microcosm and the macrocosm. And this is what you dance about with your heart when you dance praise. In fact, your heart becomes the universe. Psyche and cosmos come together. All the spiritual traditions teach this. The Upanishads of India say, they say the Brahman sits. Brahman is the Godhead. Brahman sits in the center of the human heart, where the universe is also. That's what the Upanishads say. Black Elk from the Native American tradition said the same thing. He said, Wankantanka, which is the great spirit, is found in the center of the human heart, which is also where the whole universe comes together. And in the Christian mystical tradition, we are told, like Julian Norbert says, that the Christ sits in the center of the throne, where sensuality and substance, where cosmos and heart come together. So it's an ancient teaching, and it's universal. And this is what is meant by growing your heart, the psyche reconnecting to the whole. David Bohm, the physicist, said at the end of his life, I am developing a postmodern physics that begins with the whole, W-H-O-L-E. And that's where we have to be in all of our professions, including medicine. We have to begin with the whole, with the cosmos. Cosmos is just the Greek word for whole. And from that, we can move out into our various disciplines. But reconnecting to the whole. So in dancing together tonight, we are creating a wheel. Sure, we're different spokes from different traditions, different professions, different races, different nationalities. Great. Praise the diversity. But the hub of this wheel is the cosmos itself. That is what has brought all of us here. And that is where our hearts can meet and be re-excited and grow again. Because dance is so important in this postmodern ritual, we should realize that it also is getting us into our lower chakras. And that is so important. If I could have one wish fulfilled about Westerners, it is that we would get out of our head chakras in education and in worship and get to our lower chakras. This is why there's an ecological peril today, because we are not in touch with our lower chakras, which are those that take us in touch with the earth. Now, our first chakra, as you know, is at our tailbone. It's called sacrum still. Sacrum means the holy bone. It's Latin for the holy bone. This is why we need the four-legged ones so badly, especially today. They still have their tails intact. And the first chakra is about picking up vibrations. So the tail, I see as an antenna. It picks up more vibrations of the universe than we who have been deprived of our tails. So the first chakra is about picking up the sounds of the universe. We now know that every atom in the universe is vibrating. Ergo, every atom in the universe is making sound. And this is how you get your energy back, by filling up on the dance of the atoms of the universe and the music of the sound of the vibrations of the atoms of the universe. So the first chakra is so important. That's why it's first. And we've been sitting on it for three centuries and calling that sitting education. And it shows.